Well, good morning. We'll go ahead and get started with an update on the cases. Today we have 349 new positive cases for a total of 5,868 positive cases. We have 1,668 negative cases for a total of 32,282. Yesterday, we ran a total of 2,061 tests, and a total of 38,150 Iowans have been tested. 2,021 Iowans diagnosed with COVID-19 have recovered for a recovery rate of 34%. I am also very sorry to report that we did have 9 additional deaths in Iowa for a total of 127 Iowans who have lost their lives due to this virus. Again, today's deaths are among older and elderly adults. 8 are with known pre-existing conditions, and we're still determining on one of them. As we have seen over the past week, we have significantly expanded testing across the state, which allows us to identify and isolate people with the virus, conduct case investigation and tracing, and better understand virus activity in our state and to target our response with speed and accuracy. We have also begun serology testing, which detects COVID-19 antibodies, and this means a person has already had the virus and recovered. Expanding this new type of testing is another tool to understand virus activity, which will help us identify Iowans who test positive for the virus but were potentially asymptomatic. Expanding testing is a significant advantage that we have in Iowa. Many states don't yet have the capacity to test more of their citizens. Currently, on a per capita basis, 1 in every 82 Iowans have been tested for COVID-19. And soon we'll continue to be able to expand our testing for up to 3,000 more Iowans a day once all of the test sites are open and at full capacity. And that's on top of what we'll be able to do that we're already doing. Testing, as I said, is another tool that allows us to make evidence-based decisions about how to mitigate and manage the virus with precision. Whether at a macro level or down to a specific county, community, or zip code. The reality is that we can't stop the virus, that it will remain in our communities until a vaccine is available. Instead, we must learn to live with COVID virus activity without letting it govern our lives. Like people in every state in America and countries across the world, Iowans have made significant changes in their daily lives to protect their health and the health of others. And I know it's not been easy, but staying home as much as possible, leaving only for essential errands, social distancing, careful hygiene, and isolating when sick has made a real difference. Every Iowan has a personal responsibility to do their part, and these steps must and will continue to keep us on a healthy path going forward. As governor, I had the responsibility to implement significant mitigation measures to protect Iowans during an unprecedented time, which included closing some businesses, suspending elective procedures, as well as many other things, all in an effort to slow the spread of the virus, preserve critical health care resources, and prevent overwhelming our hospital systems. However, this level of mitigation is not sustainable for the long term, and it has unintended consequences for Iowa families. So we must gradually shift from an aggressive mitigation strategy to focusing on containing and managing virus activity for the long term in a way that allows us to safely and responsibly balance the health of our people and the health of our economy. I believe that if Iowans continue working together as we have the last few months, we can protect lives and secure livelihoods at the same time. As you have seen from the data that we provide daily and what's posted online, Iowa has specific locations where virus activity is widespread, and we have areas where virus activity is sporadic and other locations where there is no activity at all. Knowing this, we can take a targeted approach to loosening restrictions on businesses and counties where there is no virus activity or where virus activity has been consistently low and shown a downward trend. Effective May 1st, in 77 counties, the following businesses can choose to reopen but must comply with certain restrictions. Restaurants, fitness centers, retail stores previously closed may reopen at 50% of normal operating capacity. Enclosed malls may reopen at 50% capacity, but play areas and common seating areas, including food court dining, must remain closed. Restaurants and food courts may operate on a carryout basis. Additionally, social, community, recreational, and leisure and sporting events will continue to be limited to 10 people, but recognizing the significant constitutional liberties involved, I am lifting the limits on spiritual and religious gatherings. In all cases, businesses and churches approved for reopening must also adhere to social distancing, hygiene, public health measures, and business guidelines from the Department of Public Health to, of course, reduce the risk of transmission of COVID-19. All other existing closures will be extended for the entire state through May 15th. I strongly encourage all vulnerable Iowans, including those with pre-existing conditions and those older than 65 throughout the state, to continue to limit their activities outside of their homes. I know that there are many more Iowans who are eager to know when their communities will begin to reopen, and I want to reassure you that we will continue to monitor all areas of the state on a daily basis for trends in virus activity. As we see downward trends and stabilization in other areas of the state, we will continue to adjust the restrictions accordingly. I want to thank every Iowan for making this possible. Your commitment to doing the right thing to protect your health and the health of others is working, but our work is not done. So I need you to continue to do your part so that together we can slow the spread of the virus and eventually open all businesses in all 99 counties. It may take some time, but it will happen. Continue doing what you're doing to protect yourself and your family, our most vulnerable Iowans and essential workers, and get Iowa back stronger than ever as possible. And so with that, we'll open it up for questions.
Governor, the University of Iowa researchers have provided some Iowa-specific modeling to your office. I'm wondering when you got that modeling and sort of what role that data has played in the decisions that you're announcing today to reopen parts of the economy.
So I'm not sure when we received the data. Do you want to take it?
So I think the white paper you're referring to, we received, I think, a copy of that early last week. And specifically, that white paper looks at publicly available data. It wasn't based on Iowa-specific information. That's the third phase of the project. So we don't have those results yet.
So can you tell us what the threshold is here for the 77 counties versus the 22?
Yeah. So what we're taking a look at is virus activity in these counties. And what we've seen is the whether they have stabilized and started to see a downward trend over the 14 days. So we're looking at new case virus activity, the rate of positivity. We're also taking into account the hospitalization rates as we've been able to monitor through the RMCCC. Data that we get on a daily basis, and we're also taking a look at recovered. Is there anything else?
Thank you. I would just reiterate, again, much like other respiratory illnesses or flu, right, we look at a variety of metrics to help us understand how active a virus is. And so that includes the elements that that Governor Reynolds mentioned, right? So things like hospitalization, case counts, and percent positivity of tests. And again, we're always thinking about the approach to this virus, keeping in mind what we know as we've learned more and as we've acquired new tools to help support public health and clinical activities to address the virus. So continuing to be flexible as we get more information and continuing to leverage the increasing resources that we have to be more targeted about that, which includes things like enhanced testing and enhanced contact tracing and case investigation.
So, Governor, the extension of closures until May 15th for those other counties mm-hmm. where I presume there's more virus activity, do you expect those closures to lift at that date as well, or is that something you're still evaluating?
Well, as I indicated, we actually can take a look at this, and we are on a daily basis, a weekly basis, so we'll continue to monitor the virus activity in counties throughout the state. I think if you look at the information that's been provided on our website, you can see that the areas are that continue to be closed are areas where we have seen significant increase in the number of cases, not only over the last 14 days, but even a little bit further than that. So We'll continue to take a look at the data and the various metrics that Dr. Pedotti spoke about, and then we'll make additional adjustments moving forward. But as we've said all along, it's a phased-in approach. We're opening slowly. I mean, we're hoping to bring additional businesses on board as we start to open up, but we'll open up with the businesses that we've just listed. We'll monitor it and see what kind of, how we can continue to mitigate it. If we're able to continue to see the stabilization and the downward trend, then we can maybe take a look at not only bringing on additional counties, but also potentially adding additional businesses to the list that we've already looked at. So we've extended it for, so these will open up May 1st. The extension of the other closures will go through May 15th, but we're going to continue to evaluate, county by county and community by community. And as we're able to do additional testing and the case investigation and the contact tracing, we're learning more all the time. And we're also able to identify if we see maybe a cluster of activity, we can respond rapidly and start to do the investigation and hopefully get in front of it and not see a huge spike in the numbers. And so I think it will also allow us to better manage the virus. And then people, still have to do their part. So if you're sick, you need to stay home. If you're a vulnerable Iowan with underlying conditions, you need to continue to, keep that in mind and stay home and not go into areas where you could be exposed to the virus.
Will the test Iowa results be separated so that Iowans can tell if they're getting their $26 million worth from the enhanced testing? Yeah. And how many state employees will be reassigned to do contact tracing?
So I don't know if I have a number to give you right now, but a significant number of DHS, Department of Human Services employees have been reassigned to help with some of the contact tracing and some of the administration of the test. But Kay, and it's not just about testing, that's a huge component of it, because as you hear every state across this country and every governor talk about what really, when they're making decisions about reopening their state and adding, bringing businesses back on, testing is a critical component of that. Not only testing, but also the ability to do the contact tracing. And with the assessment piece of Test Iowa, Iowans actually have an opportunity to be a partner in monitoring their health. So they can go on right now, if they take the test, it's not recommended that they, go ahead and get a test. But if in a week they come in contact with somebody that they found out had COVID, that was tested positive for COVID-19, we would encourage them to go back on to the website, take the assessment, so that, again, we can start to see if we see a cluster over here. If I can get in front of that, we can get in front of that sooner rather than later, we can prevent hopefully some of the significant peaks that we're seeing with the breakout. So, that's and we'll have that for a year. So we're going to have this whole system in place, and then we'll see what we do going forward. So as we move into the fall, as we move into the summer, I know people are wanting to start, summer sports or take a look at bringing some of those things online. Well, when we have the data that we have with the expertise in the Department of Public Health, and we can, I think, make those decisions based on evidence.
Governor, does anything change with this where local officials would be able to have a say in what happens in their community, or does the state continue to have that authority?
Right now, the state continues to have that authority, but I want to, continue to work with our local governments. I mean, we're all in this together, and they want to do the same thing that I want to do and all of us want to do, and that's to protect the health and safety of Iowans, especially those more vulnerable. But they understand that there's also an economic side of this too. I mean, when you think about Iowans in those 15, the Main Street businesses in those 15 communities that haven't experienced any virus activity whatsoever, they've been shut down based on kind of some statewide numbers. And so the more that we're able to drill down and really, target and be specific about where we're seeing the outbreaks, it allows our other communities to open up. And everybody eventually wants to do that. We want to just make sure that we're doing it in a responsible and safe manner. I hope that we're able to do it, by going slow, that we can sustain where we're at, stabilize, and then take a look at doing, maybe additional openings or bringing additional businesses on. But it also gives us some time, and we have to be honest about this. If we do see an uptick and we start to see some of the numbers really start to spike, then we're going to have to take a look at maybe dialing back some of those things too. That's, we're hoping that we don't have to go there, but you know, we learn every day about this virus and how we can manage and mitigate it. So we have to be, you know, there has to be an understanding that potentially as a community and as a town, if we see a spike, we might have to take some additional steps to make sure that we're doing this in a responsible manner.
So you, as you're getting
more, what about the idea of the travel? Folks have been concerned about when you open it up regionally like this instead of all at once, mm-hmm. you can have people obviously who've been cooped up for a long time who want to go out to eat or whatever it is.
Yeah.
They may leave one of these areas where it has a much higher infection spread and then go to a place that mm-hmm. doesn't and unknowingly
people have to be responsible. You have to practice personal responsibility. And so you'll be able to see where we're seeing some increased activity to a point where we don't feel that we can start to loosen some of the restrictions. And so, you know, I think that they should be mindful of that if you're going to be traveling cross counties. Do you have anything to add to that, Caitlin?
Yeah, thank you. I think I would also just add, you know, again, when we think about, as we've learned more about this virus and as the response has progressed, we take what we know about the virus, which includes that it can be spread person to person, especially when you're in close contact. We take what we know about the people who are at highest risk, so older people and people with underlying conditions, and we take what we know about how to provide and optimize care for Iowans who might need it. And so we still, you know, have seen that the majority of people, right, 80% or more are going to have more of a mild illness, and about 20% are going to have more of a severe illness. And so, you know, keeping in mind that the recommendations around people who are older or who have underlying conditions are still very important. Those people should still, you know, be staying at home and avoiding congregate settings. And also asking people to keep in mind, as we think about how public health manages a disease like this, the purpose of tools like case investigation and contact tracing is to work with people on a one-on-one basis to ask, where have you been and what have you been doing and who have you been around? And we have those conversations so that we can understand where you were and who else was at risk. And it's an example of a place where, you know, we're incredibly grateful for the partnership of all Iowans in working with public health, and of course for the continued partnership of our healthcare providers who continue to work with us to provide information about the resources and collaboration that we have to manage illness for our Iowans who are at higher risk.
So can you give them some kind of final guidance here? If you live in these 22 counties, and so many people are watching your briefing right now, if you live in one of those counties, do you recommend not traveling to an area that has been partially reopened, or do you just use your best judgment?
Yeah, so the Department of Public Health will be providing additional guidance that's going to help people understand, you know, how to approach this. And again, it's going to keep in mind all of the things that we know about this disease. So wanting to take an understanding of people who are at high risk, what being in close contact means, if you've been around somebody who's a case or who is sick. Again, those are the people that we're going to be asking to stay home, right? Because if we can be targeted about our public health interventions and asking the people who are either at high risk or who have had an exposure to stay home, you know, then that sort of allows for a little bit more of a specific response effort, right, and a little bit more flexibility. But again, I think we'll be providing additional information on that. And it's another example of a place where every day, as we learn more about the virus and as we gain additional tools, you know, in our response, we're able to work with public health, with our clinicians, and with all Iowans to help provide that guidance and keep everybody as safe and healthy as possible.
Governor, I'm curious if you can explain a little bit more about what 50% capacity means for some of these businesses. And I'm also curious, as you're lifting this restriction on religious gatherings while still saying it's not safe to gather socially, mm-hmm. you know, how those can be, mm-hmm. how people can be safe, like, while doing that.
Yeah, so the 50% capacity is the 50% capacity of the business. And in addition to that, to Dave's question also, I mean, we're asking all of them, we're asking Iowans to continue to social distance. We're not removing the restriction of gathering socially in groups of more than 10. We're asking the restaurants to make make sure the tables are at least 6 feet apart. We're limiting the number of people that can be at a table. And visiting with the Restaurant Association, they're doing so many things to make sure that customers have the confidence to come back and to eat in their establishment. So they're a partner in this, as well as the other businesses. They know that this is necessary as we start to open back up and dial back up, that these are some of the limitations that we need to put in place to do that, so that we can hopefully then watch it, manage it, and if we continue to see the stabilization, then maybe we'll move into phase two, where we can start to open it up just a little bit more. But those are things that we'll be looking at. So it's a phased-in approach as we move through opening Iowa back up and doing it in counties where we're seeing a stabilization and a downward trend for virus activity. Kay, I wanted to go back to a question that you had, too. I don't know if I completed the question, but in addition to having some of our state workforce reassigned to doing the contact tracing, we also have 150 members of the Guard that will be doing the case investigation and the contact tracing through the Title 32. So we're very, very appreciative of the resource that we're able to utilize with the Iowa National Guard, and because it is such a critical component of all of this, and we need to be sure that we're doing it in a timely basis. And as we've tested more and more, our local public health officials have done a phenomenal job, but we've just, when you're doubling the capacity of those that are that you're testing, there's just too much. And so this is a way for us to add and to build out our ability to do that in a timely manner.
Ron, KWWL.
Governor, good morning. Thanks for taking my call. Testing, of course, as you know, is underway at the Tyson plant in Waterloo, but Blackhawk County is the hot spot in the state right now. 939 cases this morning, about 95 more than posted on the state website. That's 16%, or one in every six Iowa cases coming out of this area. So you just said the state has the authority. So what is your strategy for Blackhawk County going forward, for example? I mean, would be one of your strike teams be coming here to Blackhawk County to help out, or are you just going to leave it to the local officials here?
Oh, no. We've got a strike team. We're already doing that. We'll be setting up a Test Iowa site later this Wednesday, I think, is when we'll be setting that up. And so that is coming to the Waterloo area, and we'll be scheduling those appointments through the Test Iowa, in addition to the other opportunities that Iowans in that area have to call a physician and go through the assessment and get a test. So that would be on top of their normal options that they have to secure or to be tested if they think that they are symptomatic. And so that's in addition to what they're already doing. And then we'll continue to see if we have to do additional days. Other than the one day, we'll take a look at that based on the numbers that we're seeing.
Adam, KCRG, go ahead.
Yes, Governor, on April 9th, you had pointed to the epi curve and stated that you believed you were seeing a flattening of the curve. We now see in the epi curve, since you made that statement, the cases and the case symptoms spike in that curve. Do you still see a flattening of the curve happening, or have you changed or have any less confidence or more confidence in your data? And what has changed to give you the confidence now that the data that you're looking at is accurate?
Thank you for that question. I'm going to have Dr. Pataty.
Yeah, so I think you're highlighting a couple of great ways that we're able to look at information over time. We're able to understand how trends can change, and it's helpful to look at these things not just on a statewide level, but at a more, you know, maybe regional or community or county level, right? And so I think that what Iowa has seen with our trend in cases over time is similar to what many states have seen in terms of the activity, and where we start to see, as we're expanding testing resources, we're able to identify additional cases, and we're able to implement control measures in a more targeted way. And so we continue to follow that information every day. It continues to be impacted by things like new resources and new tools that we're implementing all the time as part of this public health response. And it's an important thing for us to follow. It's one of the many things that we follow to understand trends and what's going on. And because we're adding new tools and resources all the time, we're increasingly able to look at that quicker and at a more local level, so that when we do notice something that may be driving a particular increase, whether it's associated with a long-term care setting, a particular community or household, or other sort of congregate situation, we're able to provide targeted resources and support to public health and clinicians and the communities in those areas.
Chris, KCCI.
Hi there. This is a question for Dr. Padotti. What in your mind makes you think that a sort of patchwork opening where some counties are open, some aren't, will work for Iowa, will work to keep the disease from spreading?
Well, I'm going to start with that, and then I'll hand it over to Dr. Padotti. But it's based on a stabilization, and it's based on virus activity and the amount of new cases over the past 14 days. So, you know, we're going to continue to look. And because of the tools, the additional tools that we have, we are now able to really drill down and look at the virus activity from a state perspective, from a regional perspective, to a community perspective, and eventually right down to the zip code. So again, we can start to identify early where we might see some clusters or some outbreaks, and so we can address that in a quicker manner. And so, you know, there were, as I said earlier too, there are 15 counties that have had no activity whatsoever. And so they are at a place where we can start to, in a very responsible and safe manner, start to open up the counties and start to open up the state. And I have confidence in Iowans that they are going to continue to be a part of this solution. They're going to continue to do the right thing, and we're going to continue to see hopefully positive signs of that, and we'll be able to continue to build on what we're already doing.
Thank you. So again, I think that what's important is to understand the overall public health approach to managing an outbreak as well as to disease management. So when we talk about working on outbreaks, and as I've said before, we're doing a lot of things all at once. We're collecting information, we're orienting it by time and place to understand and characterize trends at a variety of geographic levels. We're making sure that we understand who people are who are at highest risk and how we can protect our most vulnerable populations. And we're implementing the control measures that help us to limit the spread of something, which, again, as we understand more about this virus, and we still have more to learn, but what we do know, again, is that this is spread from one person to the next when they're in close contact with each other, which is similar to what we've seen from other types of respiratory pathogens. And like other respiratory pathogens, we often see differences in regions, particularly around populations or places where people gather. So congregate settings. And so again, we use the information we have so far and what we know about the virus and how it behaves. We integrate that with what we know about who's at highest risk. And that helps us to drive our control measures, which we're able to do at varying levels in more targeted ways as we gather additional tools and resources. And it's again an example of a place where I think public health in general remains flexible as we get more information and more of these tools and resources. And we're going to continue to adjust just like we would with a flu season or any other illness that public health professionals work to protect Iowans against.
We got time for two more questions. We're going to go to Aaron at Lee.
Thank you, Governor. Just to follow up on Dave Price's question about people who may be tempted to travel from some of the counties that are going to remain under restrictions to some that have been reopened, at least partially reopened. You talked about how people who are feeling sick or vulnerable population should still remain cautious, but is there not also a danger that people who are asymptomatic could also spread the virus to reopen counties if with this kind of travel?
Yeah, it's a great question. And again, it's an example of a place where I think as we learn more about this virus and its behavior, we're able to better target our interventions and resources. And so if somebody has been exposed and isn't showing symptoms, so an asymptomatic person, that's an example of a person public health would be recommending that they stay in their home for 14 days in order to limit the spread of the virus. And so again, by using our public health tools and skills of case investigation and contact contact tracing. We're going to try and be very targeted about the people who we think are at risk, the people who have been exposed. And again, our commitment remains to making sure that we stop the spread of this virus as much as possible, support our vulnerable Iowans, and share as much information as quickly as we can.
Last question. Caroline, go ahead.
Good morning, Governor. My question is twofold. First, the Trump administration's guidelines is for reopening is a downward trajectory of cases for about 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. So in terms of your rationale for partial reopening, can you explain how, you know, your reasoning to do that when that's the case, considering we've seen a surge in cases over the mm-hmm. weekend? And secondly, you talk about how there's 15 counties where there's no detection of virus whatsoever, but you and Sarah Reister have previously said, you know, Iowans should have the assumption that the virus is in their communities. And since we don't have widespread testing, it's hard to get a whole sense, a whole picture of mm-hmm. what virus activity looks like. So that said, can you, again, just answer Iowans' questions about, you know, why this is the best approach at this moment?
Do you want me to start, or do you want to start? Well, the counties that we have opened up have stabilized and showed demonstrated a downward trend for 14 days. And so that the counties that remain in the orange, they have seen an increase in the cases. And so that's why we're continuing to keep the restrictions the same in those counties, and why the counties that have demonstrated that they have stabilized and saw a downward trend in the number of cases, we've opened up or loosened some of the restrictions.
So I think your question, again, is great because it's getting at the way that we can use, you know, what we know and what we've continued to learn, as well as the new resources and tools and development of workforce that have been put in place over the past several weeks. All of the work that we've been doing, you know, with our local public health professionals, clinical partners, other partners throughout the state, as well as everything that Iowans continue to do to help allow us to use information to be more specific about guiding people through where risk exists. And that's what we're trying to do here as we integrate new information and as we have new tools and resources available. It's a way that we're allowed to be a little bit more specific in helping manage this disease on a more community by community basis.
So as we close today, I wanted to thank some of the incredible people that are behind the scenes of our COVID-19 response. And that's the people who make it possible to test more Iowans every day. On Saturday, I had the opportunity to visit the State Hygienic Lab and meet with Dr. Mike Pintella and his team. They are now running a 24/7 operation at the lab to process thousands of tests every day so that Iowans know if they have the virus and what they can do about it. So I was just so impressed with the role that they play to protect the health of our state, and thanks to them, we have the information that we need to mitigate, contain, and manage the virus so that we can get back to the things that we enjoy and value most. So thanks again to the State Hygienic Lab and their team for everything that you are doing on a daily basis. It is much appreciated, and Iowans are receiving the benefit of that. So thank you very much.